So, peeps and peepettes and bobbies and Josies and Josephines and all of that, we're going to talk a little bit about RAM and virtual machine, because I have a I have a conversation with someone in my Discord, and I think there's a lot of misconception about the whole system's relationship with the guest system, basically. And this is not meant as a tutorial on how it exactly works. This is just like giving you the 10 million miles views to give you like a bare or a good decision-making information, or you can make the right decision, basically. A lot of times to make the right decision, you don't need the detailed version of stuff. You just basically need to know how is this going to impact what I'm going to do. When you're running a virtual machine, depending on if VMware, VirtualBox, KVM, whatever the fuck you're using, they kind of use and handle RAM differently. And also, it also depends on what is your host system. Windows is way better than handling high RAM users than Linux is. Like, just open 1,000 Chrome tabs in your Linux machine, even if you have a page fucking file. It will crash. Do that on a 4 GB of fucking system. It will crash. Do the same on Windows with the same RAM specs and page file and stuff like that. It keeps running. It's just it's just how the kernel handles RAM. So that also is something you should think about. But if you think about RAM and as in like for you and me, and we're not going to do like server we're not going to build servers that are deploying virtual machines automatically and all of that fucking shit, or having big server farms with Docker containers and stuff like that. We're just talking about hobbyists at home running some form of virtualization on their desktop system, not workstation, not server, desktop systems. So now the rules are massively different from what we will be doing in a work environment, because your host system needs way more RAM than a server installer of Ubuntu or Windows need to run and deploy virtual machines. You know, they are like the athletes and we the fat fuckers. We need a lot more energy to move around. They don't. They know exactly. They have been training to do virtualization deployment shit. You know, they have been in the gym and buffed up and we can do this. We are just like that. But I also need my pizza and all that shit. So you have to always think about it. What is the use case? And most people that are watching my video and are on YouTube about this stuff, they are probably Linux users that want to virtualize Windows. So that's kind of what we're going with here, okay? We are pesky cultist Linux users that still need Windows. We're not Windows users, by the way. You're not a Windows user if you run Windows in a virtual machine, even though that you are actually using Windows and running Windows. That's a riddle for the ages, I guess. But we are a Linux user that wants to run a virtual machine with Windows. So the rule of thumb that you should go for is that no matter what Linux install that you're using, in 2023, 4 GB is kind of the minimum. What do I mean by that? That's a lot. I hear that Linux can run on a toaster. It can. But like I said, we are not a server. We are talking from a lonely, sad little non-bathed geek at home running Linux, wanted to run Windows. So we probably have GNOME, KDE, or i3 or something running. We probably have, you know, a web browser up and running like we have over here. You probably have a, you know, YouTube running in the background or music running on your host system. So you need a lot of RAM to basically keep your host system running. Way more RAM that you would be using on a server. So the rule of thumb kind of is this. Like I said, 4 GB is kind of the minimum nowadays because we have all this shit running. So whatever you're dedicated to the VM plus 4 GB. Then you should be good. You should have no problem running VMs. So let's say I want a Windows machine that needs 4 GB. I'm like, my Windows machine needs 4 GB. Or else I can't do what I needed it to do. Well, then you need 4 GB of physical memory plus 4 GB for your host system. So that would be 8 in total. Or if, let's say we are doing really, really high memory use task in the VM with Windows. So I need 10 GB as a minimum to run the software under Windows that I need to run, or else the software won't work. So that would be 10 GB for the VM and 4 GB for your host system. And some systems like VirtualBox and VMware, if you go in and allocate RAM, they will actually say to you, oh, you're going up to the upper limit because there needs to be stuff left over for the whole system. So you can't just crank up and say, oh, I have 8 gigabytes of RAM in my system. I'm just using all 8 gigabytes of RAM for my VM. The virtual machine software is smart enough to say, you know, you need like VirtualBox, the VMware needs to run on your whole system, and your whole system needs to run, and all your pawn tabs needs to fucking also be run on your system while you are doing your Windows work and jerking off to like your favorite porn star. So always, like I said, rule of thumb, the amount that you want for your guest system plus 4 gigabytes. I know 4 gigabytes is a little bit high, but rather have too much set for the whole system than too little. CPUs, if you want to go briefly into that, is a little bit of a different story. Again, we are simplifying here. If you have a 6-core processor, even with hyper-threading, in my case, I have 6 physical cores, 12 hyper-threaded. I only have a 6-core system when I'm looking at it from a virtual machine viewpoint. That don't mean that the virtual machine can't be run on all hyper-threaded cores, because it does sometimes. Again, it's way too technical to explain that in this forum here, or that's not the case with this video. You can definitely run your VirtualBox or VMware or whatever you're using on hyper-threaded cores. But if you say to yourself, I only have the amount of cores available that are physical on my system. So in my case, that will be 6. Under Windows, I would say don't go under 4. Or 2. You can go to 2-core left on your system. On Linux, you can go to have 1-core left on your system. So in my case, I have 6 physical cores. So that means that I can give my whole system 5 cores under Linux and 4 cores under Windows. And you say, oh, but you idiot, you said it has 12-core hyper-threaded. Yeah, but it's to make sure you get the best experience as possible. I could, and I have done, run Windows as a host and Linux as a guest, but Linux got 6 cores, no problem. But I didn't, you know, overtax my VM and stuff like that. And if you're really fucking crazy, again, this is too technical for what I'm going to talk about here, but I will mention it. You can also say to a lot of the virtual software, you can say to it that it only run on physical cores. So it's not regarding the hyper-threaded cores, which can also give you a little bit more performance. But again, think about it like this as a rule of thumb to get the best experience possible. You only have the RAM available you have on your physical system, and no matter what host system you're running, have at least 4 gigabytes left over to the host system. For home desktop users like you and me. CPU. Linux have 1 physical CPU left over for Linux and 2 for Windows. And you should be okay watching Netflix and stuff like that. You can't game under those systems and run a virtual machine. You get what I'm coming at here. So I hope this kind of explains a little bit about the how to look at RAM and CPU uses on a virtual, while virtual machining, or what you would call, I don't know what the fuck the term is, while running virtual machines, virtual machining, I think I would call it. It's not, you don't have to be a rocket scientist to understand it. And if you look at it at those simple things, and I will repeat myself a lot here to make sure that you understand it. I only have the physical RAM that I have in my box, and I need 4 of those to be left over for the whole system. And I need 1 core for Linux, 2 core for Windows. And I can only use the physical cores that I have, not the hyper-threaded ones. That will give you the best and most stable experience at home. And why? And you may say, why are you looking so... why are you hindering your system so much? You know, why are you not utilizing all the power of the system? Like I said before, we are doing a lot of things. Like right now, I have 2 different browsers. I have OBS, Discord, 3 different browsers open. I have probably in total 30 tabs. I have more. I have hundreds plus tabs open all over those browsers. And it's because I'm doing a lot of work with some of them. Some of this entertainment, YouTube and Netflix and stuff like that. And some is stuff I need to read. You know, you get the idea here. But I still want virtual machines on top of that. I still run Linux in VMware and gave it 4 cores, 8 gigs of RAM. But I also have 32 gigs of RAM on my system. 32 gigs physical RAM on my system. So I have a lot of headroom on physical RAM. So those 8 gigabytes I'm giving my VM is not even half of the RAM available I have in my system. So I can do all that. Had I only had 10 gigabytes or 12 gigabytes or 16 or let's say own had, well, that's probably not the correct, let's just say for the sake of argument, you get a 10 gigabyte system. If I only had 10 gigabytes in total on my system and I was doing all of these things here and running a virtual machine, I would probably get a little bit of, well, a massively part of slowdowns on my whole system. And I may be like, okay, maybe 8 gigabytes is too much to dedicate to the guest system, to the VM. The same with cores. I give it 4 cores. Well, I have a 6-core, 12-core thread, hyper-threaded. The simplest way of doing it is like I just explained. It's to make sure that you don't have to try and play smart to get things to work on your system. Because when you're trying to play smart and trying to make your system perform better than it actually is, or get more out of it than it's designed for by default, is where you get into a lot of issues. Most people that have issues with virtual machining under any operating system is because they don't follow this simple rule at home. They try to play smart and they understand a little bit about, you know, RAM swapping, CPU swapping and stuff like that. And then they think that, oh, if I have 6 physical cores, I can give both my whole system 6 physical cores and my guest system 6 physical cores. Because when the whole system needs it, it just takes the power it needs. And when the guest system needs it, it takes the power it needs. And then the whole system is just switching and swooping and blah, blah, blah in the back end. Yeah, some of that, yeah, is going on, but it's not that simple then. Now we are going into the, you know, you need to understand what is exactly going on. What can be swapped around and why is it being swapped around? And how is Windows handling the swapping versus Linux and blah, blah, blah. You need to understand all of that. So use simple rules. When you're doing anything at home, when it's IT related, the simplest rules that you can use to get something to work is the best. Because it actually gives you a lot of headroom, because operating systems are so technical advanced that if you don't account for them being technical advanced, you are setting yourself up for success. Like I said, I didn't talk much about swap partitions and swap files with virtual machining and boxing and virtualization. Even though Linux use swap files, swap partition, Windows use page files, macOS use page or swap or what the fuck they're calling it by default also. That's just an added bonus then. If I don't account for it being there, then I'm just getting a better experience because it is there. I hope this makes sense. See you all later. Bye-bye.